I'm now joined by General Lori Robinson, who's retired from military service after a 37-year career. She served as commander of U.S. Northern Command and North American Aerospace Defense Command. I call it NORAD. I don't know what all of you call it. And is the first woman in U.S. history to lead a combatant command. General Robinson, it's really a huge pleasure to meet you, and thanks for joining us today. You know, I could start out asking you about UAPs or UFOs or about that Matthew Broderick, Ali Sheedy movie in NORAD. But let's start off, I think a lot of Americans, you know, look at NORAD, look at the role you played as something that's sort of exotic. They don't have an everyday feel for the topic we're discussing today. And I'd just like to start out and say, what kept you up at night when you were running this command?
You know, first of all, Steve, thank you so much for inviting me. I'm truly humbled to be here to talk about this topic. It's incredibly important, as you have articulated. Secondly, I am old enough to remember the Cold War. What kept me up at night? Two things. First of all is Kim Jong-un as the commander of Northern Command. And if you look at my time as the commander out there, 21 missile shots, and in 2017 alone, 16 missile shots. As a commander of NORAD, responsible for defending the airspace over Canada and the United States, was watching Russia and their cruise missile capability build during my time there. So those were the two big things that I sat back and thought about and kept me up at night.
You know, I remember, as I was mentioning earlier in my conversations about spending some time at Sandia and Los Alamos National Labs, and there were people there that were part of the Reagan-era Strategic Defense Initiative when we were beginning to think about lasers and space-based systems. And you just had a sense that at that time we went through a strategic leap in terms of what's capable. We're not talking today about next-generation interceptors and begin to change our infrastructure around a bit when it comes to layered missile defense. In your experience, have we made those strategic leaps yet? Do we have something we need to jump into? Or are we moving incrementally? And I guess, are there trade-offs in security between those two approaches?
Yeah, so Steve, the first thing that I would say is we've watched North Korea roll out new capabilities, right? Even just this fall, you know, we watched them bring on a new capability. What's important is to understand that capability and then think about the capacity. You know, as I listened to Admiral Hill talk about the way that they're looking at things, I think that it is a good leap, and they've taken very hard look at what the capability is and what do we need to have to sufficiently defend the homeland. So I'm impressed. Admiral Hill, I think, spoke to it very, very well with where we've been, but more importantly, looking to the future and where we're going.
General, one of the privileges I've had in my life is I spent a lot of time in the past with General Brent Scowcroft, the National Security Advisor to President Bush and also President Ford, but also speaking of Brzezinski. And one time we had an evening where we were talking about the environment you used to command, which is really looking at space, you know, sort of missile threats that face the United States, and how close we've come in various occasions to disaster by either misreading something or accidents or then the Soviets, when the Soviets were still around, of doing this. And I guess my question is, do you have, I don't know how to phrase this, confidence is the wrong word, but do you think we are susceptible to making bad decisions in the heat of a crisis? Or do you think we've got enough layers there that we can filter through that arena of threats so that we can make smart national security decisions, you know, with missiles?
Yes, Steve. So I would tell you, in my experience, you know, if I go back to my 16 shots in the month of in the year 2017. Yeah. You know, I would tell you a couple things were so incredibly important and gave me confidence in our ability to defend and that we had the right guidance. We had clear, unambiguous guidance. But what's important also is that we trained an awful lot to make sure that if we came to a crisis, that we knew what was going to happen and we knew where we were going. So I would tell you, I know those things continue. And those things should give all of us solace, the capability to defend and the training to do so, and the clear, unambiguous guidance.
Are we keeping up technologically? You know, I've just come back from an Eastern European forum where we discuss artificial intelligence and 5G and big data and quantum computing. And I would say the consensus in the room was America was in the game, but China and Russia and other states are in it in a big way. And we're not leading on everything. And I'm just wondering, when it comes to all the dimensions, you know, of these multi-factors, you know, weapon systems like next generation interceptors and others, do we have everything we need to actually stay technologically ahead of our rivals?
So, Steve, you know, obviously I'm not in the game every day.
But retired. You have your gut, right? You have your gut about where we're going.
So I was going to say, this is America, right?
Yeah.
I mean, and if you think about the ingenuity and the way that all of our services think and all of industry thinks about these things, watching what's going on, my instinct tells me and my gut tells me that absolutely we're thinking not just about today, but the next 5, 10, 15, 20 years down the road. And it's in our DNA to make sure that we keep pace ahead of everybody out there that we would consider a threat to the homeland.
You know, I'm going to weave in some questions from our audience into my question because they're better than mine. But Alex Thiessen from Senator Ted Cruz's office asks, how vulnerable are missile defense systems to cyber attacks? Good question. We see so many else systems out there, U.S. government systems vulnerable. How vulnerable are our military and defense systems?
Yeah, so Steve, I would tell you this. I know that it is something that gets tested a lot. I know that it's something that people are concerned about. And I know writ large, the Department of Defense is very concerned and works very hard in defensive capabilities to protect the networks.
You were also, as I mentioned, the first woman in a combatant command. And I don't want to be unfair in this, but I guess my question to you, because you are a leader and I've been privileged to talk to so many other great women leaders across the field. But one of the quick questions is, how do we make that a non-issue by having so many women in combatant commands that it becomes trivial? And so do you feel like we're beginning to tilt that direction? Do you think the military and the Pentagon have a lot to learn yet on in terms of opening up their aperture on leadership?
So how lucky are we? We've got General Jackie Van Ovost and Lieutenant General Laura Richardson having their confirmation hearings this summer. It says to me, you know, as the vice president has said, and I've said, you know, I might have been the first, but we can already see that I'm not the last. And so I think that, you know, we continue to learn lessons and we continue to move forward. But we have two shining examples. If confirmed, they will be great leaders in their own right.
Let me just ask you finally, General, I really, really enjoyed this. You're welcome back anytime. We could talk all day. This has always been a you know, big interest of mine. But I get you probably participated in countless numbers of simulations, you know, with the nation you just talked about, North Korea, I'm sure also Iran. And so, you know, not to convey anything that the public should know, but when you kind of look at those simulations, how do we come out in terms of some of these accidents? Does, from your perspective, and I know that you're not tuned into the latest, but when it comes to layered security and defenses, when it comes, are we in pretty good shape? Do we need to be on the alert for the fact that, you know, North Korea and Iran are not static threats and they're continuing to move things forward? I want to give our audience a feel for that balance between security and fragility as you think about the simulations you've been through, because I know you've been through them.
So I would say it this way. Yes, we had simulations. It's training, right? I mean, you know, and we put ourselves in very difficult positions sometimes, right? So that you can learn from them. But I need to make sure our audience understands, and I testified to this, and I know that the current commander has testified to this too. I was very comfortable and confident in our ability to defend the homeland. And I think that that's what's really important. And I think what's as important is making sure that we understand both North Korea and Iran's capability and their work on capacity and their intent. And if you look at all of that, again, I will start at the very beginning. I'm very comfortable and confident during my time and as I listen to the current commander testify in our ability to defend the United States.
Are you still in Colorado or did you move somewhere else?
No, I am in St. Petersburg, Florida.
Wow, well, good for you. I just happen to love and visit frequently. I've never been into NORAD, but I've looked at it a lot from outside because I love that area of the world that you were in. But, you know, I'm glad you're safe in St. Petersburg.
I would never speak for the current commander, but I'm sure he would love to show you around.
Okay, great.
And and I'll drop him a note and tell him I told you so.
Excellent. Well, General Lori Robinson, Commander, Foreign Commander of the North American Aerospace Defense Command, U.S. Northern Command, NORAD. What an honor. I really appreciate you sharing your candid thoughts today. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Stephen. Have a great rest of your day.